Assalamu alaikum, my dear respected viewers, and thank you for joining us for this special two-part episode dealing with the governance of Imam Ali, peace be upon him. The governance of Imam Ali represented a return to the governance of justice, which had been established by the Messenger of Allah Muhammad, peace be upon him, but diverted from its course by the tyrants and oppressors. However, as the Prophet had famously said, Ali was with the truth, and the truth is with Ali. And we have a great number of prophetic narrations similar to this. How then could the government of the truth be anything other than the governance of divine justice as well? Indeed, this is one of the fundamental things that separate a true Islamic society from all others before and after the advent of the Holy Quran. One of the most important aspects by which any society may be gauged is its justice. In the Holy Quran, Allah Almighty says in part of Surah Al-Hadid, verse 25, "Certainly, we have sent our messengers with manifest proofs, and we sent down with them the book and the balance, so that mankind may maintain justice." We see time and again in the examples of Imam Ali's blessed life, both during his temporal rule as well as before it, he was always the living embodiment of this concept of divine justice. Thus, Imam Ali alayhi salam is reported to have said, "Justice is the lifeblood of the law." First and foremost, we see that Imam Ali applied the strictest form of justice to himself in the way in which he abstained from material luxuries and other benefits in which many in power today and throughout history indulge. Thus, even when we examine his lifestyle, which no amount of power could change, we find that he once remarked about his home furnishings, "We had nothing but an untanned sheepskin upon which Fatima and I would sleep at night, and upon which we would feed our camel by day." What ruler can we point to in the world since this time who lived by such high-handed principles? What kind of leader today truly leads by this sort of example? In this episode, we will inshallah be examining the example of leadership set by Imam Ali, peace be upon him, including the foundations he laid that others might follow his example in the future. Joining me in this episode is Dr. Hassan Abbas, an academic and a professor in a Washington D.C. based university. Assalamu alaikum, Dr. Hassan Abbas.
Thank you very much. It is a distinct pleasure for me to be here. It's a spiritual time and a spiritual city, and I couldn't expect anything more.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to have you, Dr. Abbas. Let's start with the first question here, Professor. Would you please provide us with a brief introduction about the theory of leadership and good governance?
Certainly, the way the different political systems worked, especially in the post-World War II scenario, which we call the modern state, it is linked to the system of government, and leadership is all about accountability. Leadership is all about, in a representative system or democratic system, it means the leadership comes out of the people. People decide who are the leaders. And leaders, in turn, are answerable and accountable to accountable to people. That's the somewhat ideal model. We have other states which are both more monarchical, or which are more autocratic or dictatorial, where some families or some individuals rule. And in those cases, the model is different. But in the modern sense, the most acceptable, popular, or legitimate system of government is where leadership is accountable and answerable to their people, and the idea of state, which I want to mention very briefly, the idea of good governance is linked with the idea of the services that state provides, where the state provides institutions of justice, where state provides institutions for law enforcement, where state provides resources for healthcare, education. So any state which provides good justice, healthcare, education, a proper law and order system and criminal justice system, these states are seen as the ones where there is good governance. All those states where all these resources of health education are restricted, these are states which are elitist, which are maybe autocratic. Only some tribes, some ethnic groups get benefit. There, in international standards, we would argue it's not good governance. And wherever where a majority of people get good resources, good support from the state, that is what the good governance is all about.
Thank you, Dr. Abbas. It seems that Islam has experienced different models of leadership and governments throughout its history. How do you consider the position of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib in Islam's tradition of leadership and governance?
The idea of leadership within Islam and of that of political system is a very critical question. I would argue the way Islam as a religion was different from other religions, let's say Judaism or Christianity, was that in Islam, the Prophet of Islam, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, had come up with two models. One was about individuals, about their relationship with God, about spirituality, and another one was about a state, how government or state is run. His time in Medina, especially after a Muslim state was set up, the foundations of a state were set up, the way the Prophet had taught others was in terms of how Islamic state will provide services, whether these are religious or these are political or these are economic. That was the model. Then I'll come to the model given by the caliphs and especially Hazrat Ali alayhi salam. However, I must mention here that afterwards, where major empires were established, for instance, Safavids in Iran, Ottomans in Turkey, Mughals in South Asia, Fatimids in Egypt and in part of Africa, all these empires had different models. Abbasids and Umayyads had different models, and we had seen some of the troubles which were provided by all these. So these were all different forms of government or different ways in which leaders led the government. The way Hazrat Ali alayhi salam led his government and established, I should say, his government was in some ways very unique and very different. Why? Because it was not family rule. It was very clearly mentioned. It was unlike what Umayyads did, what Abbasids did, what all the other main empires did. Because in all those cases, there were either families or some strong tribes which were governing. And when you have a tribe that rules, it is the interests of that tribe that are predominant. If you are Ottoman, and during in the Turkish era, all those who are the close extended family of the Ottomans will have first right in terms of education, in terms of any facilities that state provides. So where I would place Hazrat Ali alayhi salam's governance system is very different from all those, which is exactly in line with what the Prophet of Islam had said, which had two principles. One, it was the ordinary people who elected and who requested Imam Ali, please come and take over. There is no other comparable example in the first four caliphs, for example. They were, I would argue, all the four caliphs were very important. They were close to the Prophet of Islam. Imam Ali was the only one, because in other three cases, either it was personal nomination, Hazrat Umar was nominated by Hazrat Abu Bakr. The third caliph was nominated by the second caliph. It was a personal choice. I'm nominating somebody because I like him. Or in the first case, it was a tribal decision. Hazrat Ali's case was the most popular case because the ordinary people said, a lot has gone wrong in the state. We don't have justice, we don't have spirituality. And they requested and begged Hazrat Ali, please come and take over the governance. So that is number one, principle number one. Hazrat Ali became caliph not because of any favor from any tribe or not from a favor from a person who said, please, you are my friend, and my relative, please come and take over. It was because people felt that they needed Imam Ali as the leader. Why they felt? That's my second question, because his credentials were above everyone else. Everyone knew that he is the exact copy of the Prophet of Islam sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in his morals, in his character, in his attributes, in every major way or every major feature of his personality. He was the exact reflection of the Prophet of Islam sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's why people trusted him. They trusted his judgment. These were the two most important features of Imam Ali.
Yes, Professor. Imam Ali, peace be upon him, was both an educator and a practitioner. Do his insights and theoretical ideas on leadership and good governance correspond with what he's done as a governor and a political leader?
I think this is a very important point for me to emphasize, that Imam Ali alayhi salam was on one hand not only a scholar and a great scholar and an educator, but at the same time he was a great practitioner who believed in implementing what he meant and what he taught. Often in the modern world we have categorized these things that such and such person is a scholar. By often we mean, well, he cannot be a good political leader because he's a scholar. Or when we talk about a politician, we say such a person is a prime minister or president. He's a very good politician. He understands how to implement things, but he is not a religious scholar. He doesn't know. Imam Ali was the culmination of the excellence of these two ideas. And Imam Ali had established that you cannot be a good leader unless you're a good scholar. And you cannot be a good scholar unless you have the knowledge and the skills to implement what you are talking about. In terms of his knowledge, I think two quotations are sufficient. One by the hadith of the Prophet of Islam sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, "Ana madinatul ilmi wa aliyun babuha." If you ever want to enter the valley of knowledge, the gate is Ali. Secondly, Imam Ali himself sitting on member and saying, please ask me before I am no more among you. And another of Imam Ali's quotations is, I know the ways of the skies and the heavens better than the ways of this world. So Imam Ali's knowledge is not only political or social, it is spiritual, it is divine in ways as well. And all that he had gained, his knowledge is directly attributable to the Prophet of Islam. He was the one which people often forget. Muslims, and I have traveled around the world, and I asked this to many people and discussed this, and I am often surprised how little knowledge is available about Imam Ali in globally. And I'm not talking about any sectarian area, I'm saying globally. They don't understand mostly that Imam Ali, his knowledge was greatest because he had spent the best time with the Prophet of Islam. His teacher was the Prophet of Islam, and he was his most favorite student, if you may call that. So Imam Ali's teachings, as I'd mentioned, were about all issues of religiosity, but his political messaging or his knowledge about politics, all you need to do is read one book, which is Nahjul Balagha. And actually, within Nahjul Balagha, if you don't have enough time, please read one letter to Malik ibn Ashtar. And I have done some work on that, and I can tell you as a political scientist, now I'm talking about as a PhD in political studies and political science, and that's what I teach, and I'm looking at all the works of modern political scientists, about the political theories, about the great philosophers of the West, from Plato to Aristotle to Socrates to Hobbes and Montesquieu and other great scholars. What Imam Ali had mentioned about political science, about policy issues, is also in many ways unmatched, because the principles that he gave are the ones which have been taught to us by the great scholars in all various different traditions. For instance, Imam Ali's central message was, when it comes to policy issues was it is directed towards people. I have read Imam Ali's messages again and again, and he's always concerned about the ordinary people. I'll give one example. To Malik ibn Ashtar, he was saying, Malik ibn Ashtar was appointed as the governor, and Imam Ali said to him, on some days, you should invite the people in your office and tell all the government officials, the bureaucracy, that please go out of the room. Because maybe that the ordinary people have complaints against those bureaucrats, and if they are scared, what if I say something wrong about the police chief or the commissioner or whatever name you want to give them, and they are scared and they don't say it. So Imam Ali said, it is the well-being of the ordinary people which is the dearest to me. This was the principle of his policy. I'm just giving one example. I'll go to the other part of the question. As a practitioner, when he became the caliph, the fourth caliph of Islam, and as the first imam, I would argue, he implemented all that he had said over the years. During the time of 25 years of the first three caliphs, it's a very important question. Muslims at times totally forget that before, after the time of the Prophet of Islam, and before the time of his caliph, the first three caliphs' times was about 25 years. What was Imam Ali doing? Where was he? Was he traveling? There are many actually cases of that we know now that he traveled around the world. There, for instance, my question to my audience is, why people in Afghanistan, there's a place called Mazar Sharif, there's a big shrine. All the Muslims, majority of the Muslims believe that Imam Ali is buried in Najaf. I also believe in that. But there's some people who believe that Imam Ali is buried in Mazar Sharif. Why they think so? Who was there who's buried there? One interpretation is that Imam Ali had gone to Afghanistan. He had preached there during those 25 years before he became caliph, came back. But people were so much out love for him that when Imam Ali left, they said, where is he gone? And they built a small place for him saying, oh, he died, here he is, just because they wanted association with him. I traveled from the Pakistani mountains to the Afghanistan side, and I was taken to a small mosque called Ali Masjid, Ali Mosque. It has a big stone which has a sign of a feet of Imam Ali. What is the story about it? Imam Ali had gone to that mosque. So what I'm saying is, Imam Ali traveled around the world. If you look at all the great mystics and Sufis, who, as we know, all the great mystics, they believe that they get their inspiration from Imam Ali. What is the first message of the Sufia? Travel. So Imam Ali must have traveled a lot. The point I'm making that his knowledge was not purely academic from books and what he had learned. It was through traveling. He traveled around the world. He learned different languages. He talked to people in different languages. Then he came back and became a caliph. When he became a caliph, he had the wisdom that he had learned from the Prophet of Islam. He had the wisdom that he had learned through the first three caliphs' times, because frankly, like, first three caliphs were human beings. They committed many mistakes. Imam Ali was constantly advising all the three caliphs. Whenever there was a second caliph who once said, oh, if Imam Ali was not there, I would have been a dead man. Indeed, because Imam Ali saved the three caliphs from committing many of the mistakes. The same is with the third caliph. Imam Ali had sent his own sons by saying, please rescue him because he has committed mistakes and people are after him and we don't want people to blame us. So Imam Ali was acting as a practitioner even during the time of the first three caliphs. Whenever the judges in the times of those caliphs will commit mistakes, everyone will call on Imam Ali. Please, can you guide us? What is the message? So when Imam Ali became the caliph, he implemented his ideas of justice, his ideas of equality, his ideas of the well-being of the ordinary people. In this sense, he was a climax and a combination of an educator and a practitioner.
Thank you for that, Professor. The commander of the faithful, peace be upon him, built the intellectual foundations of an ideal government for the future. What were its key elements?
Another great question. I think the central principles that previously, as I had mentioned, number one is that a leader has to be popular among the people. A leader cannot be enforced, because if that would have been the case, God would have appointed angels to be the leaders so that everyone is on the right path. God had to send 124,000 prophets because that was the time of teaching. And when the Imamate began, it was the time also of the implementation of some of those great messages. So Imam Ali's the first message was well-being of the ordinary people. And Imam Ali was always saying, one of his first messages was, he had said that I am on this seat because I am answerable to the people. I'm paraphrasing what Imam Ali had said. I am more concerned about the plight of the ordinary person. For example, I'll give you an example. After he became caliph, he went out and he saw a Christian person who was in rags and who was in a very old, and he was not in a good position, and he was begging people for food. Imam Ali stopped him. Imam Ali called all the people who were there and said, so this person, when he was young, you used him as a laborer, you utilized his services. Now that he's old and he cannot earn for himself, you have left him to beg? He said, no, state will provide everything to every person. Another example, some very important people came to Imam Ali when he was the caliph. I'll not name them, these were some people who were very close to the third caliph. And they came and said, Imam Ali, we have come to you to ask our right. You are giving everyone their right. And so we have our own right. Imam Ali said, what? They said, we used to receive stipends, our honorarium. And where is that? Imam Ali, at that time, switched off. There was a candle lit. He put it off and used another one. And they said, well, why are you doing it? He said, because this candle is being paid for by the state finances. You have asked me a personal question. You have a personal issue because you were receiving special stipends. So you are here to talk to me about a personal issue. I cannot use the candle that is given by the state. So then Imam Ali explained to them, well, you have no right to get that stipend because you were getting it as a part of a certain powerful tribe. For me, everyone is equal. I will give you a money, the same amount which I can give to any poor person on the road. So I don't have it for everyone at this time. So please, thank you very much. Don't ever come back to me with that question. That was the second principle. No one is above the law. Everyone who will commit a crime, in some cases, Imam Ali, as a caliph, went to the court for witnesses. So it is about people, about accountability. It is about the justice system. And third and most important thing, Imam Ali, even at that time, and you had talked about the model was that the officials of the government have to be the most honest and competent. It is not that if I am a Hashimi, I give recruitment to every Hashimi who is living in that city. And this is a message for today. This is a message for Iraq. This is a message for Iran. This is a message for Saudi Arabia. They have to look in within the Muslim states or Bahrain or every Muslim country. Are you giving jobs only to the people who are from your tribe or from your sect or from the political opinion that you believe in? No. When you are leading, you are answerable and responsible for everyone, every ethnic group, every tribe. That is the message of Imam Ali, and he had shown it. And that's why I said his message of governance is very, very relevant to the present times, even more to this time than to his time.
Professor, I'm sure our dear viewers are curious to know this next question, the answer to this next question. What are the most important elements of Amir al-Mu'mineen's ideas of economic affairs?
There are four or five very important points, and I'll briefly look at my notes here as well. I have five examples to give you, because often people think that Imam Ali and other Imams, all that they were talking about was only about religion or only about politics. No, they were as much interested in the economic well-being and taxation system. Taxation, we often think, is a modern idea. In many states, for example, I live in United States, and I can tell you that I can do anything, but if I'm not going to pay my taxes, whatever I'm doing, I'm a great scholar, maybe I'm a member of the parliament, if I'm not paying my taxes, I can land in jail. And when I see the modern taxation system, I see this is, and I read Nahjul Balagha, I find that, oh, this modern taxation system, the principles of this system were actually given by Imam Ali. So five examples. Number one, there was a small war. So when people came back from that war, this was the time of second caliph. And they had said, the second caliph said, oh, we have won over many lands. Let's distribute those new lands into army generals, because they are the ones who won that. And they called Imam Ali, and Imam Ali said, don't do that ever. Imam Ali said, give the land to the farmers, because if you will start giving land to the army, they will start fighting to get more land so that they get more land. What a smart idea. He was saying, we need more land because to have more agriculture produce. Farmers are the ones who can create more vegetables, who can have more of the crops. So this is the right of the farmers. Very smart thinking. It was not religious. It was not political. It was purely economic. Secondly, Imam had said that in each, his quotation that is my second example is about trade and industry. He specifically advised administrators that they should live in major towns and cities. Now, this is also a very important thing, because major towns were the hubs of economic activity. So Imam Ali wanted all the smart businessmen to move to major hubs of economic activity. This again is not normally mentioned in many cases. A third example is about how Imam Ali advised his people to deal with taxpayers. Imam Ali had said to his officials that when you go to ask for taxes, just knock at the door of a person, request them to go out, don't question them about their taxes outside their homes. Take them away from their homes so that their people don't get scared that, oh, the state functionaries have come and they are trying to misbehave. And Imam Ali said to the to tax collectors, do not touch the property of Muslims or non-Muslims. You can request them for their tax. If they don't pay on the first occasion, be lenient and just don't argue with them. I'm amazed at the details of what a tax collector should do within Imam Ali's statements. One other issue that Imam Ali was very specific about, and this is directly linked to economy, is about tax collection and use of zakat. And this, the Prophet of Islam sallallahu alaihi wasallam had also said that the zakat, if everyone gives zakat, then there is no need and there is no imbalance in society, because those who are rich and wealthy are giving their share for, so that those who do not have those opportunities also get basic necessities of life. So it is not like in the modern day, some people have houses which are 10 floors and others have no roof to sleep under, and they are sleeping outside on the road. This inequality is directly opposed to the message of Islam, and that was the economic side of messaging. There has to be, yes, there will be some houses which will be better than the others, but for some people to have luxurious life and for the others to be on the streets, this is directly contradicts the message of Islam. And that's what Imam Ali had also specifically mentioned. One other quotation that I just want to mention is about hoarding and black marketing. And Imam, they were certain people who linked with agriculture who would hoard large amounts of food items and would keep those so that the prices go up and they produce those in the market. This was strictly forbidden during the times of Imam Ali. These were just some of the examples to explain that Imam Ali was not, his message was not only about religious issues, it has very important economic implications as well.
Thank you so much for that, Dr. Hassan Abbas. Now for the last question, it seems that Imam Ali's system of leadership and good governance is based on ideas about the essence of the government, as well as the personality of the governors. How does the father of the Imams, Amir al-Mu'mineen, peace be upon him, connect these two criteria to each other?
Imam Ali had done this by selecting those people at governors who had the best reputation as honest and upright people. The examples were very clear. For example, about Mawiyah, most of the problems that Islam faced, and including, of course, the great tragedy of Karbala by Yazid, we have to go a little bit back and see who had appointed Yazid, Muawiyah. Who had appointed Muawiyah? One of the esteemed caliphs. And why was he appointed? Because he was a very important political leader. Imam Ali had challenged, the first thing he did was to challenge Muawiyah by saying, you are not the legitimate caliph or a governor, because you are using this office of the governor for your own personal prestige, for accumulating wealth, and expanding your own sphere of influence. So Imam Ali's concept of governance was linked to honest and capable people. And there was a third criterion. The third criterion was knowledge. Unless you are scholarly or unless you are educated, you cannot be a good governor. And I'll close this point with one great quotation of Imam Ali, who somebody had said to him, what is the qualification to become a leader? And Imam Ali said to him, service to humanity prepares you for a leadership role. He never said service to Muslims, service to the tribe of Hashemite, service to the people of Medina. He said service to humanity. If you are good to human beings and you are scholarly, then you are eligible to be a good and important leader.
Thank you so much for your information on those questions, Dr. Hassan Abbas. We thank you so much, and we look forward to see you in the next episode.
Thank you so much. It is a great pleasure and honor, and I wish the best of luck to Imam Hussein TV.
Dear respected viewers, we have reached the end of the first episode of The Governance of Imam Ali, peace be upon him, here on Current Events. We wish to see you in the second episode, which we will discuss in depth the governance of the Commander of the Faithful. We thank you, dear viewers, for watching, and we thank our dear guest, Dr. Hassan Abbas, for joining us. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.